choice in Fernando Cortez.
Okay, so thanks very much to Jackie and the organisers for inviting me and giving me a chance to present here today. Thank you for sticking around for the final talk of Friday afternoon. I'm going to be presenting some work done jointly with Nishmal Sekula, a PhD student who finished at UCL just last year. Some work that we did in the lab of Steve Kennelly, who's sitting in the audience. And it's brand new work, so some of it may be slightly tentative, but we're keen to get your feedback and some of the results, so it's all unpublished data. Okay, so imagine you were an alien who was sent down to Earth, tasked with trying to find out something about how humans go about making the more right decisions. The first thing that you might try and do is go and ask some experts who study decision-making for a living. And they would show you an experiment they were performing that went a little bit like this. A fixation point would appear on the screen, as happens at the beginning of decisions. And then two food items would flash up on the screen, and the subject would then select one of those two food items with a button press. And the expert would tell you, well, this is an example of what we know as the two alternative forced choice. Sorry. This is an example of what we know as two alternative forced choice. And what's great about two alternative forced choice is that over the past 15 years or so, we've built up an understanding of some of the different brain regions that help to support it. So we know that when these two items appear on the screen, they get converted into their sensory properties in early sensory areas. We extract various features, as we heard about in the talk by Wolfram earlier on, which can then get integrated into these offer values that get represented in regions such as orbitofrontal cortex or ventromedial prefrontal cortex. And this allows us to compare these different items so that we can choose which one of the two we prefer. And then we convert it into an action plan in a region such as dorsolateral prefrontal cortex or anterior cingulate cortex, so that we can then generate a response in order to select one of the two corresponding actions. And so you might thank the expert for their time, but then you might go out and try and witness some examples of humans making real-world decisions. And superficially, this might look somewhat similar to the kind of decision that you saw in the lab. But as you watch them making the decision, you'd see that the subject would start to do several things, such as he'd shift his gaze backwards and forwards between the two alternatives as he weighed up the kind of costs and benefits associated with each of the different items. There might be some decisions like this one, where he just evaluated one of the choice alternatives and decided it was so good that it was worth just going ahead and selecting that item, not even considering any of the other choice alternatives that were presented during the course of that decision. And so this might give you pause for thought as to whether the expert from studying economic decisions had really captured all of those different processes in their previous account. How did this person decide whereabouts he was going to deploy his attention during the course of making this simple binary decision? How did the shifts in gaze that he made during the course of that decision process affect the neural evaluation in regions such as orbitofrontal cortex or ventromedial prefrontal cortex? And how did he decide when he gathered enough information? When was he going to stop, particularly in that last example where he only just sampled one of the options that was presented? So then after that, we might go and talk to some other experts who study decision-making in animals. And they might point out that, in some ways, the sequential decision that you just watched is a little bit similar to the kinds of decisions that animals might make when they're out foraging for food. So what these animals do is they sequentially search in different patches of an environment for items of food. Sometimes they might stay in that patch, but at other times they might decide to leave the patch that they're currently engaged with searching and go and search in a different location. And what these guys would say is that over the past 5 or 6 years, we've seen a number of investigators who've started to try to study the neural basis of this kind of sequential style patch leaving decision. Okay, so this then raises the question, how do we might try and bring together some of these different ideas. So on the one hand, a number of recent studies have begun to try to examine how attention might affect those economic choices. So work from Antonio Rangel's group, for instance, has shown that attentional sampling can really enhance the kinds of decision models, the sequential sampling decision models, in how well they describe economic choice data if we consider how the subject is deploying their attention during the course of making a choice. Work from the same group has also shown that if you look at the ventromedial prefrontal cortex bold signal, as subjects shift their attention between different items, then it seems to reflect the relative value of the item that you're currently attending to minus the value of the item that you're leaving unattended. And then more recent work from Jenny Wallace's group has gone and studied this as a neuronal level using electrophysiology in animals and has shown a similar kind of shifting of the attentional spotlight backwards and forwards during the course of a simple two alternative force choice. So what about these sequential foraging decisions that we have on the right-hand side? Well, these have emphasized a different structure, as we heard a little bit about yesterday. So these have particularly tended to focus upon anterior cingulate cortex. So what was found by Ben Hayden back in 2011 is that as monkeys build up evidence towards wanting to shift from the current patch that they're searching in and go and search in a new location, there are neurons with an anterior cingulate cortex that slowly ramp up their activity up to a certain decision threshold, at which point the subject leaves the patch and goes and searches in a new location. A similar patch has also been used to explain bold signal within the anterior cingulate cortex, which has been argued to signal the relative value of foraging versus searching. Now, as Jill mentioned yesterday, this account has been somewhat controversial, although I think it can be related to the KL divergence signal that Jill showed in her talk yesterday in ACC. And she also introduced this nice study from Alla Karpova's lab, which showed that within rodent ACC, there's a reconfiguration of the neural population response that occurs when an animal becomes uncertain of what course of action it wants to pursue next. And so it's with some of these different ideas in mind that I want to tell you about some single neuron recordings that we recently performed in non-human primates, both in these orbital and ventral regions emphasized on the left-hand side, and from this anterior cingulate cortex region that we've emphasized on the studies on the right. So what we did was we recorded from two non-human primates, the cat monkeys, and we positioned our recording chambers in such a way that we were able to access all four of the regions that are shown on this slide. So we have the dorsal bank of the anterior cingulate sulcus in red, area 13 of the orbitofrontal cortex in blue, ventromedial prefrontal cortex shown in green, and we were also recording from within the principal sulcus in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex in yellow. And so by lowering multiple electrodes into these regions, we could typically record from up to between about 10 to 40 neurons a day, sometimes simultaneously from each of these different regions. And so whilst we were making these recordings, we asked our subjects to perform the following experimental task. So it's a two alternative force choice task, where the subject has to choose between two options, one on the left and one on the right. And the subject is cued with two different attributes, one of which represents reward magnitude, and one of which represents the probability of reward. And these are cued to the animal by pictures which he's learned before the experiment begins. So he knows about the meaning of these pictures before the experimental session starts. But the trick is that at the beginning of each trial, all four of these cues are covered up to the subject. And so what the subject has to do is he has to saccade around to each of these different locations in order to uncover the information that is hidden behind these squares, in order to find out these different pictures which are going to be hidden behind the squares. So the first thing that happens is a blue square appears like this, and that tells the subject where he has to succumb in order to acquire the first piece of information. So here he's turned over a cue, which tells him if he chooses this option at the end of the trial, he's got the outcome associated with that option would be one drop of juice. After that, one of two things can occur. He's either going to be cued to make a vertical saccade, and once he's made that saccade and turned over that picture, he'll know all of the information about one of the options that's available in the choice experiment. So that happens in half of the trials, and then on the other half of the trials, he's cued to make a saccade to the other side of the screen. And so in those trials, he's learned all of the information about one of the attributes, either magnitude or probability, associated with both of the options, but he doesn't know anything about the remaining attribute. And then after he's made those first two saccades, he's basically free to do as he pleases. So what, the two remaining cues become highlighted. He's free to go and make the cards in order to turn over these pictures and find out the information that hides beneath them. So he can go ahead and gather more information. But at any point, he can also just go ahead and move a joystick in order to select one of these two choice alternatives. So if he's decided that he's gathered enough information, he can just go ahead and choose one of the items, even though he hasn't found out anything about the choice yet. Once he makes that joystick movement, all four of the pictures become uncovered, so he finds out all of the information, and then he gets the reward outcome associated with the probability associated with that cue. So here he would have received 5 drops of juice, but only would have done so on 10% of the trials. Okay, so the first question we can ask is how does the subject behave? And perhaps the surprising thing is that if we go and look at how much information the subjects choose to gather, we've recorded for two subjects here, typically the subjects are kind of impulsive. They tend to not want to bother to go and gather all four pieces of information before they commit to making a joystick response. So what we can see here is that on about 85% of the trials or so, the subjects tend to only view 2 or 3 of the cues before they commit to their choice. Do they know what the value of those pictures that they're revealing mean? To look at that, we can see how do their choices follow the values that are revealed as a function of, say, the first two cues that are revealed to the subject. So these are the option trials, where they learn everything about one option. And what you can see is that in both subjects, if you reveal 2 good pictures, you become very likely to pick this option. But if you reveal 2 bad pictures, you become very unlikely to pick that option. And similarly, on these attribute trials, where they're comparing these two attributes, if you reveal 1 good thing over here and 1 bad thing over here, then you're very likely to choose a first option. But if you reveal a bad thing and a good thing, then you're very unlikely to choose that option. You're likely to choose the other option. So subjects tend to choose the best option, the option with the highest Pascalian value, about 85% of trials. So we can also ask, how do these values that the subjects uncover on the first two cues go on to affect how much information or how subjects choose to gather information during the remainder of the trial, during the third and fourth saccades? Well, on these trials, it turns out to be rather boring. It turns out that subjects tend to go and gather information much in the same way that they're going to eventually make choices. So they tend to saccade back to this option if it was particularly good, but if it was not so good, they tend to saccade upwards to that option. But the interesting thing happens on these trials on the left-hand side. So what we find here is that on trials where the subject used two particularly good cues, then what I'm plotting here is not which location the subjects choose to saccade to, but how many cues they choose to sample as a function of the value of the first two cues that we're seeing, say, on the left-hand side here. And if these two first cues were very good, then, as you might expect, the subject doesn't bother to go and gather more information. He just goes ahead and chooses that item. But the surprising thing happens up here, in the top left of this matrix. What you see here is that if I go and look here and I see the worst possible cue, and then I go and look up here and I see again the worst possible cue for the two attributes, probability and magnitude, you might think this is sufficient information to just go ahead and move the joystick to the other side and choose the alternative option. But what we tend to find is that subjects want to go and gather the most information in those trials. It's like they want to try and gather information about the item that they're eventually going to approach or choose during the course of making the decision. So briefly, I want to go on a little sidetrack and tell you that this is also a behaviour that we've seen in a human version of the same task. So here what we did was we collected a large-scale data set from over 30,000 human volunteers via smartphone. We used this app called the Great Brain Experiment. And what was key here was that different participants completed different versions of the task. So that in some circumstances, they were asked to choose the option with the biggest product, just as in the monkey task. But in other situations, they were asked to choose the option with the smallest product. So what this means is that although the eventual goal of the subject is different between these two conditions, the actual optimal strategy in terms of maximizing information gain about which option to choose is identical between these two conditions. The only thing that you should do is just reverse your choice at the end of gathering information. And this is something that we've actually formalized using a dynamic programming model where we can calculate the relative value of sampling information in different locations. But what's key is that when we go and look at human behavior, what we find is that just as in the monkeys, the humans tend to want to sample information in a differential fashion between the two conditions. They follow a strategy of wanting to sample information about the option that they'll eventually approach in the task rather than the one which would necessarily maximize information gain. So this paper has just been accepted as of 2 hours ago. and once it comes out, the raw data from all of these 30,000 subjects is going to be made freely available on Data Dryad. And we're hoping that it's going to provide quite a rich testbed for people to go and try and explore various computational models of human information seeking. So that was a brief plug. But now I want to return back to the monkey data. And we are going to look at the differential responses across each of those four different brain regions that we were recording single neurons for. And so the first thing that we're going to look at is responses just when the first cue appears on screen. So the first thing that we can do is, rather similar to what we've seen before, is ask what percentage of neurons in each of those four different brain structures are significantly modulated by the value of that cue. And what we find is that there are neurons across all four regions which carry value-related information. And interestingly, perhaps these responses are strongest in anterior cingulate cortex and orbital frontal cortex, and they seem to follow a relatively similar time course between those two brain regions. It's not really like one seems to precede the other. They kind of co-evolve about 300 milliseconds after the cue first appears on screen. And then LPFC and VMPFC seem to follow slightly later. But what we can also do is, this is just the value irrespective of whereabouts it appeared on the screen or whether it was a probability or a magnitude cue. But we can then go on to ask, well, what happens when that picture reflected probability versus, well, when it reflected magnitude? Are there neurons which preferentially code value-related information for one of the attributes when it's a probability picture or a magnitude picture? And we can also go and ask the same question about when those pictures were presented on the left-hand side of the screen or the right-hand side of the screen. Are there neurons which have preferential coding for left action value or right action value? And so what we do, we find when we do this regression, is that there seem to be different brain regions which carry different fractions of neurons reflecting the action value or the attribute value. So whereas orbitofrontal cortex has the highest number of neurons that reflect the especially tuned to either probability or magnitude, anterior cingulate cortex and lateral prefrontal cortex seem to have preferential tuning for action value, but not for attribute value. So this is one of the first hints that we have in this data set that there seems to be dissociative coding between each of these different brain regions, and that there are kind of multiple frames of reference for value coding across each of these different prefrontal regions. So that's what's going on at the single neuron level. But what we then wanted to ask was, well, what's going on at the level of the entire population of neurons that we recorded from each of these different structures? And so in order to look at that, we performed an analysis. This was an idea of a PhD student, Archie De Burka, in Sven Bestman's lab. And he suggested that we should perform this representational similarity analysis. So let me explain to you how this works. So we can look at all of the trials where the subject is, say, presented with a particular cube in a particular location. And we can just plot the z-score firing rates of all of the different neurons that were recorded across all of the different sessions, averaged to the 0.7 probability cube when it's presented on the left-hand side. Okay, so that's what's being plotted on the x-axis here. But then we can go and look at all of the trials where the same cube was presented on the right-hand side. And so that's what's being plotted on the y-axis here. And then what we see is that there's a positive relationship, such that neurons which tended to care about this picture when it was over here also tend to care about this picture when it's presented over on the right-hand side. So we can go ahead and do this again for another picture. So let's take, say, the magnitude picture, the one drop magnitude picture, when it's presented on the left-hand side. And here we find that there's actually a slightly negative relationship. So these neurons which cared about the 0.7 probability picture when it was presented up here tend to be slightly negatively related to the neurons which care about this one drop cube in the same position. So we can then go ahead and do that for all of the different possible cues presented on all of the different possible locations. And we can just plot a matrix of correlation coefficients between the representational similarity of each of those different cues and each of those different positions. And when we do that, we see some really quite beautiful structure emerging in this OFC population response. So the first thing that you can see are these warm colours on the diagonal here. And this seems to be a stimulus identity code, irrespective of which location, which side of the screen the option was being presented on. So the neurons which are firing, say, high for the probability 1 cue on the right-hand side also tend to fire high for the probability 1 cue on the left-hand side. We can also see another feature this matrix, which is this up here. So the neurons which tended to fire more for reward magnitude also tend to fire, when it's high, also tend to fire more for reward probability when that tends to be high. And then they tend to be slightly negatively related to the low reward probability neurons. And that's replicated across all of these different blocks that we see, all of the different spatial locations. So the way that we think about this is a bit like a kind of attended value code. It tends to care about the value of what you're currently paying attention to, irrespective of the attribute which you're currently looking at. So we can then go and do this for all of the different regions that we recorded from. And what I hope you can see is that there seems to be a real difference between, I haven't put in VMPFC here, I've focused on LPFC and ACC. VMPFC is a little bit less clear at the moment. But there seems to be a real dissociation of function between these different representational similarity matrices that we see in LPFC, OFC, and ACC. So this is the average response across from about 0 to 300 milliseconds after the cue appears on the screen. The rest of the talk, I'm just going to try and break down what some of these different matrices might mean in terms of what information they code about the different features of a decision that the subject might be making. So the first thing that we can maybe do is, instead of just averaging across from 0 to 300 milliseconds, we can perform that same representation similarity analysis, but we can just slide it from relative to when the cue first appears on the screen. So at this point in time, the subject makes a fixation, makes a saccade to one of the locations, and the first thing that you can see is over here with DLPFC, we get some spatial information about where the subject first looked at. And then we can see this stimulus identity information that emerged in OFC that I was talking about earlier. And kind of concurrently with that, we see some value-related information emerging in both OFC and ACC. So that was kind of a bit of eye candy, but we can just average that back together and we can pull out these differential responses across each of the three brain regions. But what I hope you saw from that sliding representational similarity analysis is that there seem to be very distinct signals that were being carried in each of these different brain regions, and they seem to be carried at somewhat different times. So the first thing that we can see is that in lateral prefrontal cortex, the most dominant feature of this RSA matrix is spatial position, whether the subject is looking at the left-hand side or the right-hand side of the screen. It does have a little bit of value information, maybe a little bit of stimulus identity information, but the dominant feature is stimulus in the spatial location. And I don't have time to show you this, but this seems to be relatively consistent from cue to cue. So if you're a left-preferring neuron, say Q1, you also tend to be a left-preferring neuron at Q2. And there's also some spatial information within LPFC about up versus down spatial position, as well as left versus right. Okay, so now let's think a little bit more carefully about the orbitofrontal responses. And so what we were arguing previously was that this representation that we saw up here might be carrying a code a little bit like an attended value response, a response which signals the values of the item that you're currently paying attention to. So the next question we can ask is, well, how does that evolve as the subject shifts their attention from one location to another around the screen? And so the trials that we're going to focus on here are these attribute trials, where the subject shifts their attention from one option on one side of the screen to the other option on the other side of the screen. And I'm actually going to do something very similar to what Andy showed in his talk, which is we're going to look at the responses of all of the neurons to one of the variables. So we're plotting the variance explained, or the coefficient of partial determination for Q1 value. And we're going to time lock it to Q1 here and to Q2 here. So you can see that when Q1 appears, it cares a lot about Q1, and then this slowly decays, but we still have some information about Q1 at Q2. And then we can do the same analysis for Q2 value. So time lock to Q1, obviously there's no information that seems to be being encoded there, but when Q2 appears on the screen, then we get a nice bump that seems to reflect the value of Q2. And then just as Andy did in his talk, we're going to look at the population of neurons, which seem to be reflecting this quantity here, and ask, how do they relate to the neurons which seem to be reflecting this quantity down here? And so what we find when we do this is the following pattern of responses. So down here, we can see that the neurons which carry information about the value of Q1 when you were attending to Q1 are also the same neurons that carry information about the value of Q2 when you shift your attention to look at Q2. But then when we look at this point in the matrix, so we're looking now at Q2, time-locked entirely to Q2, then what we find is that there's a negative relationship, such that the neurons which code positively for the value of the item that you're currently attending to, Q2, now code negatively for the value of the item that you just previously looked at, Q1. So this seems to be a lot like that signal that we saw in that study by Antonio Rangel, which seems to be a signal in orbital frontal cortex which is carrying code for the relative value of the item which you're currently paying attention to the item which you've left unattended. So we can go and ask, well, is this signal present in any of the other regions that we recorded from? And although they all show this attended value signal, so all the same neurons care about the value of whatever you're currently paying attention to, when you shift your attention to the other side of the screen, it's only orbital frontal cortex which has this negative attended minus unattended code. Okay, so orbital frontal cortex seems to be carrying a signal which perhaps reflects an attention-guided value comparison. So this leaves us with anterior cingulate cortex. So here the analyses are kind of somewhat tentative. They've been performed over the past week and a half or so, so take them with a grain of salt. But I want to tell you about the thing which currently excites me the most. So the first thing that you might notice about this representation similarity matrix at Q1 is that it doesn't seem to quite have that nice linear gradient structure that we saw in orbital frontal cortex. Instead, what it tends to have is this more block-like structure, such that if I see a high-valued Q, 5 or 4, it tends to look quite a lot like each other. And if I see a low-valued Q, 1 or 2 or maybe 3, those also tend to look relatively similar to one another. And so it's almost like this matrix is kind of discretized into this outcome, which I just looked at, is really good, or this outcome, which I just looked at, is not so good. It's not so good as I anticipated it might be. And so what this led us to think was kind of going in line with some of the studies that Jill was talking about yesterday, and some of those studies from the foraging literature, was that ACC might be not signaling value per se. It might be carrying a code which seems to reflect whether or not you should confirm your current expectation as to whether the item that you're looking at is going to be a good item or not such a good item. And so the way that we went to look for this was then to ask, well, how do these neurons which care about value at Q1 that we saw in ACC, how do they tend to perform when we shift our attention to the same option, but we don't look at the representation of how similar they are to Q2 value? Instead, what we're going to look at is the interaction of Q1 and Q2. So what we mean by this is if we saw, say, a 5 and then a 5, then this would be another piece of information which kind of confirms my current beliefs, because this interaction term would be high. If we see a 1 and then a 1, then the way that we've set up this interaction term, it's also going to have a high value. And this second time that we see a 1, it's going to also confirm my current beliefs. Whereas if we see two things which are very different from one another, say a 1 then a 5, or a 5 then a 1, then it's going to kind of disconfirm what I currently believe. So what we then predict is that if we were looking for a signal which carried something related to belief confirmation, then these same neurons which coded something kind of similar to the value at Q1 would also tend to care about this interaction term at Q2. And so that's what we see down here. We see that there's a positive relationship between the neurons which code Q1 value at Q1 and Q1 by Q2 value interaction at Q2. And so this is admittedly extremely tentative evidence that ACC might be carrying some information about whether or not we should carry on thinking about our current hypothesis at Q1 and Q2, or whether we should reject that hypothesis and shift to a different belief. And so as a kind of further test of this idea, we can then go and look at that exact same relationship, but on the attribute trials. And here on the attribute trials, a high interaction term has the exact opposite meaning. So if I see something that's bad on this side, then I might think, oh, the other option should be good. But then if I go and look over here and I see something that's bad, and I think, oh, well, that option's not so good either. And so what we predict was that the neurons on this trial, which care about Q1 value, Q1, also tend to negatively care about the interaction term Q2, and that's what we see in ACC. Okay, so that's kind of the story so far. We are still exploring this data, and so we'd be delighted to talk more about possible ways in which we can further try and test these ideas. But I'd just like to finish by trying to summarize some of the things that I told you about today. So I was trying to argue that anterior cingulate cortex, orbitofrontal cortex, and lateral prefrontal cortex all have single neurons which seem to reflect value across different frames of reference. These regions seem to show distinct population responses during this reward-guided information search and choice task. And behaviorally, both cats and humans tended to sample information in locations that were really associated with expectation of future reward over and above information gain. And I'd like to finish by thanking Steve and Nish, Tim Behrens, who's also been involved in this project, and Archie de Burke, who's helped us with the RSA analysis. Thanks.
So you showed us the OFC in the attribute trials. What happened to the option trials?
So in the option trials it does something really very nice as well. So you'd think that it would basically sum up the value of Q1 and the value of Q2.
Or multiplied.
And it does exactly that, but it tends to do so only once you've shifted your attention onto the other option. So when you go and look at the relationship of value 1 coding and value 2 coding at Q3, those two things are positively related, and they tend to be negatively related to a value of the Q that you're currently attending to.
If they choose for looking at the option 3? If they choose the other option?
If they choose, I don't know the answer to that.
Hi, great data. Just a very quick question. You said that in prefrontal cortex, you see that there's a spatial representation. Is that contralateral, or do you sample the whole space in each of the two sides?
So we sample from both hemispheres. I don't think we've seen any particular ponderance towards having contralateral tuning in lateral prefrontal cortex, but I can go and check. I don't know that off the top of my head in the current data set, but I'm sure that is known in LPFC neurons, but I don't know the answer.
So.
I was really interested in the last part of your talk, and I was wondering if you could interpret the data in terms of evaluating the decision of, you know, going there instead of going there. So if, you know, you went there and there was an information gain, it was a good decision, and if you went there, it was a bad decision. So could you relate that to, you know, performance monitoring and the involvement of the ACC in performance monitoring in general?
I think the interesting way probably to unpick that ACC signal a little bit further will be to try and relate it to how the subjects then go on to gather more information during the course of the task. And I think that we would expect that if it does reflect something about monitoring whether the thing that you're currently looking at is say particularly good and you don't need to sample more information, then those same real populations should probably show quite distinct responses. Distinct responses than on trials where you don't go on to sample more information. But it's a relatively new analysis, so we haven't yet tested that.
Any other questions?
Thanks for a very rich talk. So if I understood you well at the beginning, you set us up with this kind of weird unexpected behavior where even though monkeys or a human know that they have revealed a choice that will be a bad choice given the space of choices, they still need to seek evidence that the other one is better. And then you left me a little bit waiting for where is that signal coming from? Why do we do that? Like, do you have in your neural data something that points to why is there such a drive?
We haven't yet managed to find. We have gone trying to look for some variation in how many cues you might bother to go and look for as a function of ACC signaling. That was done before we did the population analysis. And there is a little bit of evidence explaining, but it's not as strong as maybe we would have originally hypothesized. But one thing that I can say about the human data is that it seems to, so in that same app that we were collecting the data from, we also have another set of tasks that the subject performed. One of those tasks indexes Pavlovian approach, which seems to just be modulated by levels of dopamine. This was work done by Rob Rutledge. What we found was that variation in how subjects perform that Pavlovian approach task, which he's found to be dopamine dependent, co-varies with how much information subjects need to gather, or some of the biases that we see in information sampling in our task. So I think that there might be an interesting role for dopamine in that approach-induced biases in information search.
Okay, I just propose that we go to the discussion, and I see that there are other questions, but probably you can raise the points you want to raise during the discussion. So thanks again.